we all are the founders of AMF together. Amen. Amen. Today, AMF was founded. I didn't say we're going to found AMF. Ministers met, and you were there that very day. And we're all raising together. Amen.
Amen.
Of course, yes, somebody called the meeting. And we call it the gathering of the eagles. Amen.
Amen.
It was just a normal meeting, no title, nothing. We all discussed together and we felt this is worth doing. And we all bought into it and we said, let us do it. And at that time, there was no name, if you remember. We didn't have AMF. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
It was later on that the idea of, okay, what should the name be, came up. If I remember very well, I think the name AMF came from Apostle Adagwele, not even from me. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
And then the inscription, our motto, working together for the kingdom of God, came from Pastor Reggie, not from me. Amen. And the first meeting of AMF actually took place not in Deeper Life, but Gospel Faith Mission. If you remember, yeah, the first meeting of where we decided we're going to have a pastor's forum was in Deeper Life. But, and so I want to remind us, amen, so that we don't put attention upon just one man. If any attention at all is to be put, let's put it on God.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Let's put our hands together for him. Hope that is not taken from my time. Amen.
Amen.
It's a pleasure having everybody here in the house today. Amen.
Amen.
And the God of heaven will bless us.
Amen.
Let us pray. Precious Father, we are grateful because of who you are. Eternal God, we glorify you because you are the Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness, thank you for your goodness, your greatness, thank you for these great men and women of yours. We are great because you are great. We are great because we are connected with you. We are great because you made us great. And Lord, whom you have lifted up, nothing can bring down.
Amen.
Speak to us today.
Amen.
You have called us for a purpose into the work of your ministry. Even in your vineyard. And Lord, there is no way we can do the work without the honor of the work. Without instruction, guidance, leadership, and direction from you. So Lord, we came this morning again to be taught of you.
Amen.
Speak to our hearts.
Amen.
So that the work will prosper.
Amen.
And that our labors will not be in vain. Hands that are down, lift them up.
Amen.
Heads that are bowed, raise them up.
Amen.
Hopes that are lost, rekindle them.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
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 I got a call from the secretary within a week that I will be ministering today on the challenges of church growth. Challenges of church growth. And I think this is something that we all need in our lives. This is something we all need in our ministry, no matter at what level of ministry you may find yourself. The challenges of church growth. The Bible tells us that Jesus is our great commissioner who has commissioned us to this work. And so as we look at this, I will do my best to make it interactive if possible, if my time will permit. If not, I will just make it a relay race and keep running and then keep following, pursuing. Praise the Lord. We are going to be looking at four main things. I'm not going to be saying point 1, 2, 3, 4, but these are the things we're going to be seeing as we begin to get into the depth of this seminar. We're going to be looking at the master. We're going to be looking at the minister. We're going to be looking at the mandate. And then we're going to be looking at the ministry. Shall we all say that? The master.
The
minister.
The
mandate.
The mandate.
And the ministry.
And the ministry.
Everything I'm going to be saying are going to be revolving around these four things. Matthew chapter 28. Looking at it from verse 18, the Bible says, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them all things, or teaching them to above all things, whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. And everybody say,
Amen.
Amen. If you don't know any other passage of the scripture in ministry, please know this one we have just read. If you cannot memorize another passage of the scripture, please memorize this particular one. Because this is where the master gave the mandate. This is where the master commissioned you and commissioned me. And please understand, Jesus is the one, and he said, all power is given unto me. That tells me that in order for me to succeed in this work and ministry, I don't need my own power. I need his power.
Amen.
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 And so, I don't need to do it my way. I've got to do it his way. He said, go into all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe, not my own way. Teaching them to observe, not my own church. Many a times we try to draw attention to our churches, and we fail. At other times we try to draw attention to ourselves, and we fail. It said, teaching them to observe, how many things?
All
things whatsoever I have commanded you. Understand, what we are doing is a great commission by a great commander. And disobedience to this great commission is a great disobedience. Please understand. And he finally said, he said, look at it. Every step you take, every step of the way, he said, look, lo. No matter how far you have gone, he said, look back, I am with you.
Amen.
How often?
Always.
When the winds are blowing, I am with you. When the storms of life may be raging, I am with you.
Amen.
When it appears that you are lonely, I am with you.
Amen.
When all seems to be gone, I am with you. He says, lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world, he will be with us.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Most churches seem to face growth barriers. Almost every church faces growth barrier in life. And many a times, pay attention, because most of the churches here are struggling churches. But God will take us from struggling to surviving churches.
Amen.
And from surviving will be successful churches.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You may not understand when you get started, depending on how you start. Understand there are people that started right, there are some that started wrong. I'm talking about those that started right now, not people that are grabbing members from different places, pulling them out from other churches and say, come and start. No, that is not the right way to start. It's a matter of time. The people you stole will end up stealing from you. Whether we like it or not. Is that the one they call the law of karma? Amen.
Amen.
Whatsoever you want others to do to you, what do you do? You do it to them also. If you don't think it's good, then don't do it to somebody else. So we are all confronted with this challenge of church growth. When you struggle and struggle and struggle, you start here with just yourself, your wife, maybe your children, maybe four of you, or five of you, or seven of you, depending on your family number, and then you are able to minister to people and you get started, well, by the time you get to 25, sometimes you begin to plateau. The problem begins almost as early as the number 25. And then you struggle and struggle and struggle and struggle, and then it's like there is no end. Then you get to the number 50. Then you tend to plateau again. If you don't follow some of the things we are going to be talking about now, not that alone, you go from 50, you get to 75. Hooray! We are growing, we are growing. If care is not taken, you're going to plateau right there. And there is nothing like stagnation. It's either you're moving forward or you are. You didn't get it. There is no stagnation in life. It's either you are progressing or you are retrogressing. It's either you are moving forward or you are going back. Look at it. You have 100 members and you are happy I have 100. And that 100 is not growing beyond 100. The day one person is absent from church, how many do you become? You become 99. So understand that you must continue to grow. Continue to grow. When you go from 75, you get to 100. From 100, 125. And on like that. But Church Growth Institute made us to know that once you are able to hit 300, then you are beginning to climb. But still, if you are not careful, you can still plateau there. But from 500, you can go to any number. Because whatsoever got you to that level will keep you going. It's an indication that you have been a worker working on things. You have defied all the challenges before that time. And because of that attitude, the tendency for you to keep on growing is there. Now, somebody said, how do I grow my church? How can you grow your church? And we have been told by those that are experts in church growth that that is a wrong question. It's a wrong question because every living thing grows. Whether you like it or not, every healthy thing grows. Healthy organism. The question should be, what is hindering my church from growing? Understand, Jesus said, behold, I will be with you always. So, your church is not growing up because Jesus is not with you. Something is wrong with your system. Something is wrong with your strategy that needs to be looked into. So, what is keeping my church from growing? Understand that God wants your church to grow. I need an amen. And so, you now conclude and decide within you, I also want the church to grow. Is there anybody here that doesn't want the church to grow? You want to see the church grow. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 17, verse 20, he said, and because of your unbelief, he said, because of your unbelief, for verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, remove from hence to yonder place, and it shall remove. Our churches will grow.
Amen.
He ended by saying, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. So then what do we do? If you are going to see your church grow, you must be proactive. You must be able to think ahead. You must be able to plan ahead. And you must be able to stay ahead of growth barriers. I repeat, be proactive. Say, tell somebody, be proactive. What does it mean to be proactive? Somebody help me. I told you I would try to make it interactive. What does it mean to be proactive? Anybody?
To think ahead.
To think ahead,
Anticipate problems before they occur.
Anticipate problems before they occur. Yes, another person?
To act. Put in the right action.
putting the right action in order to prevent problem or save situation. Yes.
Acting ahead of time.
Acting ahead of time. But many a times, what do? All of us. We are reacting. We wait until there is problem. That tell you this, if you're going to be successful in life, always assume there is going to be a problem. Think ahead of the problem, plan ahead of the problem, get solution to the problem, so that if and when it eventually happens, you have the solution at hand. You're not running helter-skelter. Praise the Lord. So, be proactive, think ahead, plan ahead, so that you can stay ahead of growth barriers. This is the best way to overcome. Remain faithfully aligned to God, to His plan, and to His purpose. Remember, the tendency for you to want to do it your way is there. Remain in the will of God, and the Lord will help you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So let's quickly get into all these barriers to growing the church. To growing the church, I have quite a number of things here, and I hope to finish them within the time frame I have. Number one is motive and mandate. The motive and the mandate. Matthew chapter 22, verse 14 says, many are called, but few are chosen. Many are called, but few are chosen. Please pay attention. Many churches are having issue because we all, if you look at so many churches today, so many churches, everybody is called today. I think somebody said that earlier on. Was it Pastor Missy said, Timmy? Everybody is called today. No. Understand. There is a call, there is a call. Many are called. Many are called unto salvation. Many are called into godliness. Many are called into holy living. But not everybody have been called to be a pastor. Many are called into different ministries, but not everybody is called to be a pastor. And many are in the ministry because of fame, because of money, because of women, because of whatever. What is the motive behind the ministry? Some got into it so that they can keep their own tithe and offering. Some got into it because they are calculating. By the time this one pay tithe, that one pay tithe, that one pay tithe, we are already in money already. If that is your motive, understand that's what is going to kill or destroy you. What is the motive? Are you really called? We have this challenge in the ministry because not everybody is actually chosen by God to be in the ministry. Many are called, but few are chosen. Jesus gathered them together, out of which he chose how many?
12.
Whom he called disciple. Number two, ministry challenges. It's going to be M series. Everything I'm going to be talking about is going to be M. M, M. You know why I'm using M? Because miracle is following somebody.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Ministerial challenges. God is looking for fat people. What did I just say? He's looking for fat people. Fat. Robust people. Who are the fat people? Number one, you must be faithful. Number two, you must be available. Number three, you must be teachable. Fat. Are you faithful? It is required in stewardship that a man be found faithful. Are you available? Are you available for the work of the master? Are you available where he needs you? Are you available when he needs you? Some of us want to do it at our time, not his time, availability. Availability. Look at it. This is supposed to be ministers' forum, and if you look at many of us came late. Availability. Praise the Lord. And then, are we teachable? Or you are just a man on your own? The Lord will help us.
Amen.
If these things are not there, our churches will not grow. The leader sin is a leading sin. Number three, manner management. Our churches are not growing because of our manners. What do I mean by manner? I'm talking about attitude. Attitude determines altitude. You need to understand the need for you to be a people person. The need for you to be able to walk with people without compromising the faith, without compromising the truth. Manner management. Many years back, you were very, 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 actually you have to pray for 41 days to be able to see my teeth. I don't smile. Amen. What did I just say? I don't smile. I was too holy for that. One day in the 80s, a lady came to, we were walking together, and one day the lady said, if it remains me and Mr. Dada in this office, I will run out. This was around 1984. And I said, remember the name, because what she said hit me so hard. I've forgotten so many people's names, but her name, I didn't forget. And I said, Mr. Diakose, what do you mean? Now, since I won't talk, I won't laugh, I was just busy with my thing. And I didn't know that with all of those, my face was looking scary. Amen? So I lifted up my head and I said, Mr. Diakose, what did you just say? And she said again, if it remains me and you in this office, I will run out. I said, what do you mean? She said, each time she looks at my face, it looks scary. Scary game. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
But she was right. She was right. Be a people person. And then there was another time in the church. I'm using my own life experience now. So you know what is holiness and what is not holiness. Neil was going around in the church. And then, I didn't even know the people till today, but I know those who brought it to me. You know, there are some new casters, there are some new carriers. And then they said he spoke yesterday. I had him. And another one will be saying, no, it must be somebody else. No, I had him myself. What were they talking about? They said they had me spoke in the bus. Meanwhile, they've been saying that he behaves like deaf and dumb. He doesn't really relate with anybody, he doesn't talk to anybody. Amen?
Amen?
If your life is like that and you want your church to grow, you need to repent. You may not be committing sin. Do you understand? But you also may, your life may be dispelling people. It was then I said, but am I not talking? So some of these things getting back to me made me to know there are things I need to change in my life. Tell somebody, you need to change some things in your life. Manner management. Be cheerful, be accommodating, smile. You still can be frank. I think when there is need for me to be frank, I am always very frank. I don't take nonsense. But at the same time, I smile with people, I even hug people, I do high five with children and all the rest. And that wasn't me before, but the church must grow. Those days you say, hi, pastor, I will have your mouth. Who is your hi? Do you say hi to your father? But now you say hi, pastor. Oh, hi, son. You will die with your holiness. You will not be able to take anybody with you to heaven. Amen. You will become Elisha. Your bone will be raising up dead body. And how many dead body did his bone raise? Only one. Your life will not be minimized.
Amen.
Your ministry will not be minimized.
Amen.
Number four, maturity. Maturity. You need to mature. Many of us are stagnated in our, and again understand, it's either you are growing or you are retrogressing in your life. When I say maturity, I'm talking about self-development. Develop yourself. Attend seminars. Attend retreats. Attend conventions. And don't just limit yourself to what your church is doing. You can always learn from anybody, from everybody. Trust me, I came here this morning and I learned something, and then I looked around for somebody I could say, pay attention to this. I couldn't find the person, so I just kept it to myself. Check up with people around me. I tell them, anywhere we go, they go with me. Don't look for what is wrong with that church. What do you look for? What you can learn from that church. Many of us are too proud to learn from others. You are too full of yourself. And yet, no matter how high you have gone in life, you can. The Bible even say, you sluggard, go to the end, ants, and learn from her ways. If we can learn from the ant, not even from the elephant. And the Bible is giving us an example of a mustard seed, not the biggest seed. Understand, you can actually learn from people you think are nobody. The Lord will help us.
Amen.
So, expose yourself, educate yourself. The Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, that's 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. Study. And most of all these materials are online for us now. But if all you do is just go make money and then come on Sunday to minister, hey, it doesn't work like that. You're going to be repeating yourself. You're going to be resenting the same old way. Try to be proactive. Tell somebody
proactive.
The Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. When you are developing yourself, your church will be developed.
Amen.
When you are stagnated, your church will be stagnated. I have other things to share there. But I'm looking at time as well. But understand that your congregation can never outpace the inherent qualities of its leader. Your limit will be the limit of your congregation. Mm-hmm. Your level will be the level of your congregation. So personal development is essential to church growth. Many of us, our churches are not growing because we are not developing ourselves. You know the Bible, John 3:16, yeah. Genesis 1:1, everybody knows that. Revelation 25, verse 15. What does it say?
Nothing.
I just gave you a test right now. Do you have Revelation 25?
No,
you don't have Revelation 25. Praise God. But if I didn't tell you, some people just think, oh yes, I'm still quoting the Bible. I have gone outside of the Bible already. The Lord will help us.
Amen.
Amen. When pastors are not growing, the sermons are stale. The congregation's passion for ministry will wane. The staff will stop growing. The church will stop growing. An intentional reading plan is the single best avenue for personal growth. make it deliberate that you want to educate yourself. Amen.
Amen.
Schedule time to attend conferences. Number five now. Meeting place. Meeting place. Your meeting place. What's the first thing I mentioned, everybody? I don't want to lose anybody. One.
Motive
and mandate. Number two.
Ministerial
challenge. Number three.
Manner
management. Number four. Maturity of leaders. Praise God. Number five now. Meeting places. Your location. Location, location, location. Where are you having your meeting? Are you fellowshipping in an unclean place? Is your location too small or too big? If time permits, I will explain how the two can be a problem. Your location was moderate enough. Do you have an easily readable road sign for your church? Or your church is in a place that nobody can easily know that you are there? Is your church in a secluded place? When I use the word secluded, I mean isolated, very quiet, very private. You are using a house, you are using a basement. Churches never grow that way. Never grow that way. And when I said, is your church too small or too big? I deliberately skipped that because I need to talk with somebody, our host pastor here. He needs to hear this. Praise the Lord. Now, if we are talking about church growth, for instance, their church in this place, this room on the average supposed to seat like 30, 35 people, conveniently, comfortably. Amen? But you know, as of last Sunday, they were over 70. What were they doing? Parking themselves here. Parking themselves here. From experience, when your church becomes saturated and there is no room for people to stay again, what will they start? What will begin to happen? It will start dropping. It will start dropping. So every Sunday, make sure you make room for visitors to come. Extra seat for them to come. Not too much that you make it look like you are a drop in the midst of the ocean. But at the same time, comfortable enough for people to see, not packed like sardine. Somebody say amen to that.
Amen.
When people come to your church, do they feel like, oh, this looks good? The decoration in your church, the presentation of your church, or your church is such that all kinds of things are everywhere. Especially we that says we are, who are we? African. African. Go to places and see how churches are being decorated. Many a times we put too much things on the wall. We think the more things we have, at least if you don't have the member you have, you have decoration. Be sure your church is located in a place. Now, let me quickly say this. When you see churches that are using, like where Pastor Reggie is using, where
Pondo,
thank you so much, churches don't grow there. Since we are ministers and we are trying to help ourselves, and by God's grace, over the years, I've done some studies on some of these things, churches don't grow there. Especially if you don't have a big church that you can have membership transfer. Not that you may not get somebody, but we're talking about real growth now. You want a place where people are passing by and then they can see the sign of your church. This church here, because they are renting it from another church, For years, you don't see any new person coming. Until they now began to devise a strategy and put some sign by the roadside. And then somebody will say, oh, we saw the name. If they don't see your name, they don't know you are here. Am I communicating?
Yes, sir.
Your location. So, many a times you say, is the devil? We are praying and fasting. Stop praying and stop fasting. And then start acting. Be proactive. Think smart. Think fast. Amen.
Amen.
If your church is too close to cemetery, relocate. Our location at New York, we were trying to buy a property, and then they saw one and they told me I should go and look at it, and then I went. It was a very nice property. You know, parking is an issue at New York, just like DC. And I went around, it was in the night, and I said, now we got it. And then just before, as soon as I got inside my vehicle and I was to take off, the thing just said, look ahead. And I look ahead. What did I see ahead? It was a very huge cemetery right in front of the place. Cemetery, very big one. Then that night, I now look around the area. A lot of the businesses are boarded up. So those that told me, I said, I have been there. That area is meant for the people on the other side. Now come to think of it, you come into a church and the first thing you see around you is symmetry. Now think of it. Sometimes we leave to you that the dead spirit of the dead will come around. Location matters. What's the number now?
Six.
Number six, maintaining the standard. The standard of God's word. 2 Timothy 4:2. Preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. Please pay attention here. If you don't do the right thing now, you will run into trouble later on. Have a standard for your church. Be known for something. If you don't stand for something, you will fall for everything. People will not know where you stand, and your church will not be able to grow. The moment your members know the truth, what will they do? They will leave you. They will leave you. On my way here, somebody just called me, one of the pastors from one of the states, asking for counseling. Here is this individual belonging to a particular church. I won't mention the name of the church. She divorced the first husband, married the second one. And she's a worker in that church. And supposed to be a big Pentecostal church. Because they need members, her life was okay today. But then, God spoke to her. She had a dream. The rapture took place. And she wouldn't make the rapture. And she knew this marriage is an issue. So now, she now went to that of our pastor asking for counseling. Stand on the word. Amen?
Yeah.
Now, the lady couldn't go to her pastor. They knew her situation, but because they wanted to keep her at all costs, what did I just say? At all costs, they cannot confront the truth. Maintain the standard of God's word. Number seven, ministry challenges. Ministry challenges. What I mean by that is, don't make one department more important than the other. All departments are important. You may end up having challenges in that ministry. Let me give you an example. The cleaning ministry. I know you won't say, is that a ministry?
Mm-hmm.
What is the better word? They call it here.
Sanitation.
How, thank you, that's what I'm looking for. Housekeeping ministry. Don't say sanitation. Don't say cleaning. What do you call it?
Housekeeping.
Housekeeping ministry. Now, we Africans, we may not take this serious. When an American family comes to your church, my people should know that because I've dealt with them so many times and days. A family comes to a church, where is the first place they will want to go to? You almost got it. The number one thing is the children's section. Amen? Children's department. Because they're going to leave their children there. They are not there. They don't know what is happening. How safe is the place? How secure is the place? Who are the workers there? And so on. That is their life. They want to pay attention to that. The second place is what you mentioned. Where is it?
The restroom.
And you know, it's the restroom we don't pay so much attention to. Our restrooms stinks. Smells. Restroom. All the attention we put on the sanctuary. But unfortunately, people are looking beyond the sanctuary. They're looking beyond the sanctuary. You know, when we did our sanctuary in our church in DC and people came, I was surprised that everybody, some people got in there because they know how it used to look like anyway. Now they got in there, they almost collapsed. Are we in the palace or we are sitting in the bathroom? Praise God. And some people took that to their church to go and pattern it exactly. I'm talking of even on deeper life now. Anybody likes good thing?
Yes.
When you go to restaurants, their bathrooms are not looking great. You know why? They don't want you to stay long in the bathroom. They want you to come to where they will make their money. Church is the exact opposite. Am I communicating? And you don't know that these little things affecting the church. The growth of the church. Your church, everything has broken down and you don't care. You get to your church. I got to a particular church, it's a Deeper Life church, and I won't tell you the name of the place. And then there was no soap in the bathroom. I refused to leave the place until the pastor brought me soap. Be sure there is always soap, there is always water. Be sure your bathrooms are clean. Get people that always take care of it. All right, let's move forward. Somebody say forward.
Forward.
Your ushering department. Ushering department, how is it? Your publicity and marketing department, how is it? I know we don't say we have the publicity department. You know, as I was preparing this, I began to learn some things I need to work on. I told you every living thing grew, right?
Amen.
I need to grow myself. So now I know that I need to have a department called publicity or marketing department. Every company has that department. Do you notice that? Most of the things you watch on TV, what are they? What comes up most of the time, no matter what you're watching, something comes up most of the time. Advertisements. What are they advertising? They are products. We don't have that in the church. And we expect the church to grow. We don't invest into areas that are needful. All we do is just pray. And prayer is good, but we forgot that prayer needs to work on something. Prayer needs to work on what?
Something.
If you are doing nothing, your prayer will work on nothing. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Your children's department, your evangelism, just make sure that you have people in all those areas. Now, I'm going to leave music till the end. But it's part of this also. Prayer ministry is very, very important. Very important too. So, ministry challenges, if you don't pay attention to these ministries, those problems will pay attention to you. They are called barriers. They will hinder you. Now, you say, but pastor, my church is small. How can we do all this? That takes me to the next one, manpower challenges. Manpower. Listen to this. God will not give you more than what you can bite. If God has given you the people, God will take care of them for you in Jesus' name. Amen. Luke 10:2 says, the harvest truly is plenty, but the laborers are few. Pray therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his vineyard. If your congregation suddenly doubles now, do you have the manpower to handle them? Manpower. Manpower. That now calls for training of people around you. No matter how few they may be, train them. Train them. If someone is absent today, what happened to that department? Close down. No. No, what I do is, I try to make sure that one person does more than one thing. Even if I have more than enough hands, am I communicating? I make sure, and I rotate people around from time to time. Some don't understand. Some may think, well, they don't like me here. It's not a matter of like or not. One, I am raising up every member around me to become a minister. And if you are only limited to just one area as a minister, maybe I should still say this, I have told my own people, that as a pastor of the church, you are the departmental head of every department in your church. Including, but not limited to the bathroom. Am I communicating? You are the sectional head. And so you should be able to know at least what goes on in every department. It doesn't matter what it may be. Media department, you are there. Electronics, you are there. Ushering department, you are there. Choir or singing ministry, you are there. Whatsoever the department, you may not have in-depth knowledge, but you have at least a surface level knowledge of everything going on. And be a blessing to them. And be able to instruct, guide, direct. If you don't know, go and learn. Go and learn. Once again, check with the pastors that goes out with me when we come to your church. What are we doing in your church?
Learn.
We are learning. Yeah. Hey, my God is good, though. Even that alone, I'm looking at, how are you saying, hey. I'm just exposing myself to you now. Amen. I'm looking at how you're moving your body, whether you're moving it in a holy way or in an unholy way. Praise God. I'm looking at your church decoration. I'm looking at your organist. I'm looking at your carpet, your floor. I'm looking at your seat arrangement. Now, you have a church and then your members are 25. And you have about 5 different colors of chairs. You have green there. You have yellow. You have blue. You have brown. Which other one do you have? You turn into a masculine church. Excuse me. Am I communicating? You don't know, people pay attention to all these things. And then the dilapidated chair from your house, you brought it to the church. The one that they are selling the last chance, you brought it to the church. You know what I mean by last chance? It shall be well with us. So manpower, train your people. Develop your people. Educate your people. Expose your people. Expose your people. Never, never shy away from training. Membership retention is the next one. That's another challenge we have in the church today. How do we retain them? This can only be done by and through our follow-up system. Follow up your neighbor. Again, if you link up with manner management I mentioned, what are some of the things I talk about? Our attitude?
Be cheerful, smile.
Be cheerful, be, smile.
Be a humble person.
Relax yourself. I'm not talking about being frivolous, no. I can be smiling with you and then I see something wrong and then I become a different person entirely. Not because we are friends and then I cannot tell you the truth. Amen?
Amen.
Many of the people coming to your church have challenges in their lives. They are looking for someone to talk to. If they are not available, they will go elsewhere. They will go elsewhere. And then say your church is not going. Wherever they keep on going, they may end up going there. And become a member there since you are not available. I went to one of our locations and I visited a member there out of town. And then the brother said, Pastor, I've been in our church for this number of years. My pastor does not know where he is. Can you imagine? So I called the pastor and said, you want to grow your church? You need to repent. Go back to the cross. You have not stolen, you have not told a lie. But this is what I had. And he didn't argue it. He said, Pastor, I will change. You will change.
Amen.
Who is in charge of your follow-up? Now in our church, our major challenge is follow-up. Trust me. I'm talking about our own church. Not that people don't come, but how is the follow-up system? Very, very poor. Very, very bad. And I know some of our people will not be happy with me saying that. But trust me, some things you read in the Bible, if they're not there, there'll be nothing for us to learn from. Am I communicating?
Yes.
So don't get mad with me that I'm exposing us outside. We are learning from one another. And I'm saying it is BAD. What do you call that one?
Bad.
The follow-up system is bad. Many of our locations. But we will change.
Amen.
So that next time we deal with this subject, I will come back to AMF and say, we have changed.
Amen.
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 So, very, if we're going to retain them, follow up with them, have committed people in charge. Don't put somebody in charge that you go and be telling everybody about your church. Don't put tap water in charge of follow-up. You know what I mean? Someone at the mouth is...
They have diarrhea.
Okay, diarrhea. Okay, they have diarrhea in their mouth. They are the ones that know the bad brother, the bad sister, the one that divorced, the one that is they were to marry and they didn't marry. They are the ones that know, if you know the pastor's family, let's just give everything with God, daddy. When we get to heaven, what is that person doing with your new visitor? Poisoning their mind and then sending them out. Be careful of who you put in charge. Study them, examine them. And don't send a brother to say, go and pick up a sister, and then they ending up in the hotel together. Amen.
Amen.
Then the next one is mentoring of new converts. How do you mentor them? This is different from follow-up and visitation now. How do you mentor them? Do you have any discipleship class in place? If not, design one. If you can't design one, go get from another church. Please understand, every church is learning from every church. Anything you see anywhere is not unique with anybody. Somebody learned from somebody. That is part of how to develop yourself. Even nations learn from nations. That is why the spying community will never, never go away. America will spy on Russia. Britain will spy on America. Russia will start spy on Germany. Why are they doing that? What do you have that I can? You understand? How can I secure my base, my house, my country? Otherwise, why do you think, as small as Russia is, America has not just been able to get up one day and run them over? They're not that big. They knew they made their first mistake, and then the Soviet Union collapsed, and then the manager says it won't happen again. Unfortunately, it's not going to live forever anyway. Amen? And if you don't know, the man came up with a submarine that showed up in which country, just showed the nose a little bit and then went back before they knew it. He was in their land, the international water, there.
Wow.
America was boasting that we build the shield, the defense, or whatever they call it, and sending to Poland, sending to all those people, and then they manufacture something that they said shield buster. They are all monitoring one another. Amen.
Amen.
Go to your neighbor church. See what they are doing that is helping them to grow. Don't just sit tight. You may not like them, please understand. And there are a lot of churches I don't like what they do, the way they do. But there are some things they are doing that I need to learn from. What do? I go there. I go there. Where is Pastor Yenga? I know his PC out there. Praise God. Where is he? Okay, he's far away. Thank you so much. Well, I'm just saying that I don't just go learn from others. Sometimes I send people out, go to this church, go and see what they are doing. I need to build this area. Amen. Sometimes I will go together and I say, get up, go talk to this person, go concentrate on that area. So if you see us growing, it's not just that we know it all. That's the point I'm making. We're learning from you. We're learning from you. Learn from us too. And then mentor your members. Build them up. Develop them. Establish them. What's the next thing now? Amen? Money mantra. I call it money mantra. I didn't say money mantras. Every now and then the issue of money comes up. You want to do this? We don't have money. We don't have money. Listen to this. You will never have enough money to do all you need to do. You never have enough money. And I don't want anybody in life that has enough money. Who's the richest man in the world? Huh?
Bezos.
Yeah, somebody took over from Big Data already.
Amazon
owner. All right. Why is he still in business? Wants to make more money. More, the quest for more. So, if you're saying because you don't have money, you can't do some things, you are wasting your time. Amen? Let money never be a monster to you. Let money never be a manager to you. But rather, let money be your messenger. And it will be in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Then avoid greediness. A lot of pastors are greedy. A lot of pastors have sticky fingers. Except the money doesn't pass through them. Something was diminished from the money. Trust God for breakthrough. Amen.
Amen.
Then I told you music, and worship. How many of you enjoyed the praise worship this morning? I do too. Praise God. And you know, we don't even have drum. We don't have guitar. We don't have a clarinet or whatsoever. But the people singing, the person playing the keyboard, everything worked together. And see, there was life here. Music brings life. Music brings life. If you don't have a good music in your church, if you need to go and hire somebody, godly person, though. Don't go hire a drunkard because you want music in your church. Go hire somebody. Pay them. Pay them. And many a times as I was preparing this, I've been talking about stuff. Because I also again have to research what are the challenges in ministry. Beyond what you think you are going through. And then I realized that many a times you need to hire somebody. And I've been talking about hiring, and I was thinking about money. Now, money is not my problem anymore. If you don't say amen for me, I will say it for myself. Yeah. Yeah. Praise God. Hallelujah. When you have the right person in the right position, the money will come. Because the services of that person will turn things around. More people will come, the money will be generated in such a way that it will not be a problem paying that individual. And yet, as long as the person is not there, the people are not there, the money is not there, and you are limited. You will not be limited.
Amen.
That is something we always cry about, and the fact that people are relocating, that's why our churches are not growing. That's not why your church is not growing. Because people will always move. Do you know the fruit that is called mango?
Yeah.
Divide it into two. No, don't divide the fruit, the name, divide it into what do you get?
Mango.
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 Mango. The man has gone. People will always move. Whether because of job related, family related, church related, whatsoever is making them to move, people will move. If you are doing the right thing, so they will move to your church. Am I communicating? When they come to your church, your own church will grow. So if 5 people come to your church and 1 leave, will you feel it?
No.
No, you will not feel it. So the challenges of church growth is more with us. God has called us. He has commissioned us. He has equipped us. He has empowered us. And he has engaged us. How are we doing the work? Let us pray.